Good morning, everyone. In this session, I am going to talk about the major aspects related to research in engineering and sciences, and also one of the promising area of research, that is sustainable development. What are the various forthcoming and upcoming areas in which one can do research with respect to sustainable development, which cover almost all the aspects related to all branches of engineering as well as sciences. So when we talk about research, basically research process is the work which is required to enhance our knowledge of how to best address the problems in the world. A good research work, it produces results that are examinable by the peers, methodologies that can be replicated, and knowledge that can be applied to the real world situations. Research leads to expansion of knowledge. Research process is iterative. That is, we have to plan our methodology for doing research, but depending upon the intermediate results which we receive upon doing the experimentation or following some methodology to meet to our problem which we have identified during our literature survey, we have to change certain variables, or we have to iteratively develop these so that it can meet the research criteria which we plan. And it doesn't matter whether the research it gives 100% success. Of course, research, it will lead to something which is new, which it is required for the expansion of knowledge. But maybe the hypothesis or the assumption which we made, that if by following a certain strategy to solve our research problem, some of the parameters or some of the success points which we had kept in our mind before starting the actual research may not lead to successful answers. So it is a part of, again, research. That is why after the research, again, we have future scope of work. So it is an iterative process which continues. It is a systematic investigation and study of materials and resources to establish facts and reach new conclusions so as to shape understanding of the world. Research is an original contribution to the existing stock of knowledge, making for its advancement and development. It is the pursuit of truth with the help of study, observation, comparison, and experiment. The search of knowledge through objective and systematic method of finding the solution to the problem is the main crux behind any research. The systematic approach concerns generalization and formulation of the theory is also the research. That is, the research solution which we have found in certain situations, it needs to be replicated to other situations, similar situations also across the world. So that is the important characteristic of the research. The two important characteristics related to research are the systematic procedure, that is, we have to follow the literature survey, we have to review what has happened in the past for a particular area of the field, and also how it has been done, what are the gaps, and what do we want to do in that research gaps. We cannot cover all the gaps in a single go. We have to limit our research which is practicable. So we have to think very critically when we search or formulate our problem for carrying out research in any area. And thereafter, we also select the methodology to carry out our research. And then when we do the research, again, some iteratively, we have to change our path for carrying out the research to get the solution to the problem which we have envisaged in the earlier stage. So research is systematic. It follows certain steps that are logical in order. And these steps are understanding the nature of the problem to be studied, identifying the related area of knowledge, reviewing the literature to understand how others have approached or dealt with the problem. It is very important. That is why the backbone of any research is going through very good literature, which is the work done by our scientists or researchers in a particular field, and thereby to identify the research gaps. Then collecting data in an organized and controlled manner so as to arrive at valid decisions. Then we have to analyze the data appropriate to the problem. We have to validate it also statistically and otherwise through experimentation. Then we draw the conclusion and make generalization and also highlight the future research areas in the particular area which we are working through. So it has certain systematic procedure, that is, we ask the question, what problem is to be solved, identifying the most important factors which influence our research area, formulating the hypothesis, that is the assumed or educated assumptions which we have on certain small evidence, but which we need to further investigate and validate in our research process. Then we have to collect the relevant information. Then we have to test the hypothesis, maybe through mathematical modeling, through experimentation and measurements and so on, depending upon the type of research. Then we have to reconsider our theory if something is not going out of context. And then again, a new question is asked, that is, what is the further scope of research? So high quality research is the need of the hour. It is based on the works of others. It can be replicated. That is very important point. It can be replicated and duplicated to other similar situations also. It is generalizable to other settings. It is based on the logical rationale and it is tied to a theory. It is doable. That is, it can be implemented. It generates new question or is cyclic in nature. Once you do a research, it doesn't mean that all the work related to that particular area has finished. No. Some new future research options will emerge when you will try to solve the research problems. So it is cyclic in nature. It is incremental. It is not that at a within one research of, say, if you are doing a PhD or MPhil thesis, then all the immediately you will get to the end of the solution. No, it's not like that. It is in a small measured quantity, because it is addition of new knowledge and it requires a lot of efforts and to work upon it. Now, what is not a good research? When we do something, but we are looking for something, but it is not to be good. Our research or our problem formulation is not correct. Or that might be one of the reason. Then plagiarism. Other people's work. That is, we just copy what other has done. So that is also not a good research. Falsifying the data to prove a point. That is, we manipulate the data and present it. That also is not a good research. Then misrepresenting the information and misleading the results. So these are not acceptable, these things. So one should think critically and one should avoid all such type of diversions which a person may come across than doing the research work. Now, today we want that our research should be known globally. It's very much required that whenever we do research, we should be careful. We should not follow or we should not copy what other has done. And it is a great issue. And you might be knowing that in today's world, when everything is available on our internet and we can access what is going across in the world in a particular area. So it is just a matter of time if somebody copies and do something, and it is going to be found out. And later on, there is a very harmful repercussion with respect to the plagiarism. Like you might be reading the newspapers that some of the authors who have done the work copied from the earlier researchers, they have been banned from the from a certain, you can say, very esteemed journals to publish their articles. And also even some of the national institute, they very strict view in doing who does like this. Like there may be the threat to his job and his future career also. So one should be very careful, and so whenever you do the work, because when you are doing work, sometimes a person says, maybe unintentionally also, the person doesn't review the literature in a width. So it is very much required that we know what is happening around the world. We, when we do the literature survey, we should not limit our research to even journals. We should be thorough in reading the index journal, SCI index journal. These are indexed by the Thomson Reuters. We should go and we should definitely look deeper into all the articles related to our particular research area. Another thing is we should also look into the patents. You see, whenever we have the technology on our laptop or smartphones available these days, when you'll go and try to find for the literature, don't only limit yourself to good journals. You should always seek the information pertaining to the patents also in that particular area, which is very much required, and also to the commercial devices or instruments or maybe the technology which is available in that particular area. Because sometimes what happens is a person thinks that is a new research area and he's going to develop a new product or innovate a particular technology during his research. But what happens is after 4 or 5 years, when he concludes his research, he could see that the same product is already available and commercially available. So all his or her efforts will just be wasted. So it is very much required that we keep ourselves abreast of what is happening around. Once you are doing a research, you should thoroughly read all the upcoming and latest articles or latest publications of all esteemed journals, so that your research should be valid when you conclude the research. Otherwise, if other scientists are also working in the same direction and they complete this research work before you do, then your research will be invalid. So you have to be very much alert in this particular area. So we have to, whenever we want to quote or rewrite someone else's script, we should quote the source. And we should not write as the other person work as our own. And then cutting and pasting the internet material, that also comes under plagiarism. Publishing someone else's result without permission, that is also questionable. And reproducing someone else's figure or table without quoting the source, that is, we have to quote the author, the year, and the source from which we have taken our figure or table. That is very much important. Otherwise, it leads to plagiarism and the and problems. Now, there are various types of research which are being done across the world. One is exploratory or formulated research study, which exploratory type of research is to gain the familiarity with the phenomena or to achieve new insights into it. Studies with this objective are termed as exploratory. Then descriptive research studies are those which portray accurately the characteristics of a particular individual, situation, or a system. It studies with the object. Diagnostic research studies covers the determination of frequency with which something occurs or with which it is associated with something else studies with this object in view. It is called as diagnostic research studies. Then hypothesis testing of research studies are also carried out. They are to test a hypothesis of a causal relationship between the variables. Then the systematic steps which are followed for conducting of research are being discussed now. One is describing the methodology of research. It covers that we should state the purpose of the study and define the problem clearly. That is, we should know what is the aim and what we are going to do. What problem or what issue we are going to planning to solve or doing through research. So this guides in deciding the methodology of result, and it involves identifying the method of research, that is how we are going to do our experimentation or maybe mathematical modeling and simulation and measurement and observation. Specifying the subjects of the study, whether it is a heat flow problem or maybe like some other problems related to cloud computing and so on, or smart grid. Selecting an adequate representative sample of subjects, that is minimum number of if you are going in for experimentations, or we are going to going for exploratory type of research study, then we should know how much number of the respondents should be there, minimum number of respondents. So that is very important. If your sample size is small, or your experimentation method, it has number of samples are less, then it is not a validated, it cannot be validated. So we have to be clear about that beforehand. Then selecting or constructing valid and reliable instruments for measuring the variables in the problem. This is very much required. Sometimes what happens is we do the research, and what happens is whatever is the reference or the reference our experimentation, that is carried out in a wrong way. Like if we are going to calculate about the moisture in the grains, and we want to validate it, the standard oven this oven drying test. And what happens is that without knowing, unknowingly, the person goes for wet bulb based reference. But actually, it is a dry bulb based of type of base which should be taken into consideration. Then in the end, whenever you have done your work, again, it will be questioned, and then it will be a problem for the researcher. So we should be very much clear about the instruments or the reference or measuring of our experimentation when we are dealing with research. So it is very much important that we have a very good review and survey of the literature to see what our earlier researchers have done. Right? Then selecting a research design and describing the procedure to be employed for conduct of research study. Then collecting of data is a next step. This step involves conducting the study as per the design procedure, that is manipulating the experimental variables. In the case of experimental methods, we should know what are the independent variables, what are the dependent variables, and what are the boundaries of our model. We should see very carefully. Administrating the instruments for measuring variables, it should be properly calibrated if we are measuring something, otherwise our results will not be proper, like this is one of the example, or gathering information through observation. Now what is to be observed, for example, if we are taking an exploratory study and we are just we are using our, what happens is if the data is being collected and the person, what happens is whatever is said by the respondent, he or she tries to change the words and write it in his own way, then the meaning of the information which is provided by the respondent will be entirely different. So we will not get the correct information regarding the human behavior, especially in the field of social sciences, when we are conducting or recording the respondents' response. So that's why it is always advised that we should have the audio recording or video recording when we are getting the information collected through questionnaires from our respondents. So that is also one of the methods which is employed very much across the world to get the valid information and true information from the respondent. It also involves tabulating the data thus collected for the purpose of analysis. It is very much important to analyze our results, because based on the data tabulated, we are going to analyze our results, and the results of the study generated are analyzed and they are summarized to provide information for testing the hypothesis. That is what we assumed in the beginning. What do they? It stands. How much far it stands against what we have assumed initially. Then the appropriate statistical methods of analysis are used to test the hypothesis. This is very important. Sometimes we see, okay, our result, they match with what the and you can say results or standard or controlled groups against which we measure. Then we apply statistical analysis like t-test or ANOVA to verify whether statistically our results, they give us the output which is required. Because unless or until our results are statistically validated, they do not carry the weightage. So that is very much important. Then the performance of maybe performed analysis can be done by manually, by if you have a limited number of or experimentation results, or maybe through computer software as per the demands of the problem or available facilities. Now, after completing the analysis, then we have to summarize and conclude what we have found. So that is very much important. The next steps in conducting research, that to it. So that has to be coherent, right? Then consistency and inconsistency with the results of other research studies. Some of the results, it may be fall along the line in which the work has been done, might not match with them. So there might be certain reasons, maybe some experimentation misbehavior during equipment might have been there, or maybe some other parameters might be there which can be affecting it. So that is another thing which comes out from the research. And then what are the major conclusions, or what we have actually found out, what are the findings which we have done when we have carried out a research. And then after that we write our research thesis or report, and also we do the research publications, or if it is an innovation, that is creating of new thing, then we file the patent. Now the major categories of research. It is not matching. Our slide, that is categories of research, they are the main types of research are exploratory type of research, constructive research, and empirical research. Now, exploratory research, it covers bear with us for a moment, there is some connectivity we have to see. This may jo उसमें कुछ और प्रोजेक्ट हो रहा है, मैं कुछ और बोल रही हूँ. ये मोबाइल से तुम लाइन करके देखो, यहाँ पे इतना भारी होगा ना.
ब्लास्ट कर रहा है यार.
ये रखने के लिए ट्राई कर लो. Okay. So sorry for the interruption, there was certain technical snag, and now we'll continue with the research methodology and the overview of the research. Now the major type of research, they are the exploratory type of research, in which structures and identify, which is based on the structures and identifies new problems. Then constructive research, which develops solutions to an existing problem. And empirical research, which tests the feasibility of solution using empirical evidence. So this is based on the observation, experimentation, or experience. And generally our engineering and science research, it is based on the empirical research methodology. So major types of research are two types. They are quantitative as well as qualitative. Now, as you can see, the quantitative research is based upon collection of facts and figures and measurements, and it is most common method for which is common in the field of science and engineering. So it involves experimentation and measurement of the results. Then qualitative research, it is based on collecting opinions, attitudes with respect to human behavior. And this type of research is common in social sciences. So these are two major types of research which are being done across the world. Then engineering research, for example, it seeks improvements in theory and practice in the fields like high-speed computation, bioengineering, earthquake prediction, power systems, nanotechnology, and construction. Now, as I was discussing before, the most important and initial aspect of any research is the review of the literature. Review of literature is an account of what has been published on a topic, what has been done by the accredited scholars and researchers. Our purpose is to convey to the reader that what knowledge and ideas have been established already on the topic which we have chosen, and what are the strengths and weaknesses, or what are the attributes and limitations attached with the already work done by the different scientists and researchers in that particular field. So research must, the literature review must be defined by the guiding concept, that is the research objective, the problem or issue which we are going to search upon, and our argumentative thesis. A good literature survey has certain characteristics, that is, it is a focused. Our topic should be narrow. We should not try to cover all the thing in our research area. For example, the research gaps will be definitely higher as compared to what is our research problem which we have formulated to carry out in our research work. So we should only present the ideas and not the report on the studies that are called closely related to the topic. It should be concise. Ideas should be presented in a gist, small gist way. And we should not take more space. We should not go on writing about what others have done. It should be in a very concise form. It should be logical. That is, maybe like from the year that earlier it was done, maybe in 1800 and so, and thereby in the chronological order it can be represented. Or maybe if you want to highlight any technology or different aspects, that maybe various aspects can be enumerated in a logical sequence, right? So that is very much required, that is, there should be logical and smooth progression from one idea or one research work to another. Then we should always completely project what others have done, what are the attributes, what are the limitations of a particular work. It should be integrative, that is, how the ideas in the studies, they are related to each other. And what commonalities all the studies share, how some studies are different from others, and how all the studies reviews, it really has contribution to our research topic. And very much important is that we should always project or always write about the latest work of research in the particular field in which we are going to work upon. So sometimes what happens is, suppose we are going to submit our thesis or and it is, say, completed in 2016, but then one should ensure the latest work, like maybe some publication which are related to the same field and which has been done in the current or 2016, they should always be mentioned in our thesis work, right? So that it should validate that whatever we have done, it is not being done anywhere. Then a good literature review should be organized and related directly to the thesis or research question which we are developing. It should synthesize the results into a summary of what is known and what is unknown. And it should also identify the areas which are mismatch in our literature and formulate the questions that need further research. That is the project or problem formulation. So the working with literature has a various aspects. One is finding, that is what we should find and know what are the literature types. Then using the available resources, then manage it, that is we should read it efficiently and across all the references and writing the relevant annotations. Then choosing our topics, developing our question and giving our rationale of doing the research and informing our work with theory as well as the methodology to carry out our research. Then we have to review, that is what is the existing or ensuring the adequate coverage of the work being done in that particular area, writing it with the objective, and we should write it in a way so that it should be consistent and it should not be more in a critical criticizing type of way. We should not write for any author, because whenever we do some research there is always some gaps, so we should be clear about that our writing style should be in a specified and in a right track. We should write our literature. Then we have just discussed about the research gaps and problem formulation. Then one of the methodology to solve the research may be modeling and simulation. Now what is modeling? You see, from the man, he has been curious to know about the nature, and this has led to many discoveries and inventions. And to understand the governing laws of nature in his own way, the man has created a model. Like you might be knowing about the Newton's law of motion, that how a force affects the motion, for example. So models are of many types. Basically, a model is an object or a concept that is used to represent something else. It is a reality scaled down and converted to a form which we can understand. Now, it can be conceptual model also. That is a model of physical situation made in the thoughts. That is the first step for any type of modeling. Another is the physical model. Now, physical model is model made of substance. It's like a model airplane made of wood, plastic and glue. Another is mathematical model. Now mathematical model is translation of a given physical information into mathematical form, leading to a mathematical model of physical situation. This model may be of differential equation or a system of linear equations, etc. Then the researchers also formulate sometimes a computer model, that is, it is a virtual model of the physical situation. With advances in computer hardware, software, any shape or size can be graphically visualized through computer simulation. So these are the pictures which represent that what is the physical model, what is the mathematical model. Like physical model, you can see there is a picture of an aeroplane, right? And then physical model is like mathematical model is when there is an equation, Newton's second law, which everyone knows about it and very much is familiar with it. That is mathematical model. Force is equal to is the product of mass and acceleration. Then another picture shows how the computer model is formed. So mathematical model, if we discuss, it is represented as a functional relationship of the form of dependent variable, which is a function of independent variables, parameters and forcing function. Now dependent variable is that which reflects the state of the system. Independent variables are dimensions such as time and space along which the system behavior is being determined. Then parameters, they reflect the system properties or composition, and forcing functions, they are external influences which acts upon the system. And the variables, like studying the effect of distance on the transmission delay in the radio telecommunication, and the distance here, the distance is an independent variable and the delay is a dependent variable. Now the simulation, then all the three models, that is physical model, mathematical model and computer models, they are simulated to match with the real physical situation by applying proper boundary conditions. That is very much important when we formulate our model, that what is the boundary under which particular situation this particular equation or simulation is valid. So that is boundary conditions are important to formulate. Then experiments are also carried out on the physical models, and effects of various parameters they are studied to interpret the reality whenever we do the research. Now mathematical models are solved considering true boundary condition to match with the real situation, that the boundary condition should be factual, right? And then computer simulation, it is a complex mathematical models which consider the realistic boundary conditions and they are solved to the computer. Using graphical user interface, the simulation can be seen occurring on the computer screen, and you might be seeing variety of three-dimensional views of a particular problem which we are going to solve. So they basically depict the computer simulation. Now some of the examples of the medical model is, as you can see, there are equations which are represents the aircraft flight or stress analysis, or maybe heat transfer and forced vibration. So we here, these are the some of the examples of the various phenomena and how we mathematically model it. Now these mathematical models can be linear algebraic model, differential model, optimization model, statistical model or artificial intelligence model. The advantages of simulation or the benefits of simulation are that once a model is built, it can be used repeatedly. Simulation data can be less costly to obtain than the data from the real system. And these methods can be easier to apply than experiments and analytical methods. Simulation methods are more general and require less assumptions. And sometimes it is only way to derive the solutions. Like if you are working on something which is related to space and so on, then generally we simulate the conditions which are there in the space and then we do the research. Now there are some of the tips which can be followed for conducting the research in the area of engineering. One is that after we have selected and defined the research problem, then we can conduct the research. So by following or reading as many books, maximum number of books or papers as much possible in that particular area, and we have to understand it, whether it has been written by the non-researcher or whether it is commercially available or whether the patent has been applied. So we have to be very much careful when we try to scan the literature. We should cover all the aspects related to various types of information available with our research area. Then do not just read a little part of the research. We should read thoroughly and all the paper to understand to have the in-depth knowledge of the particular work which has been done by the scientist. Now suppose we do not understand, sometimes it's difficult in the beginning when we read the paper, then you have to read it twice or thrice or maybe five times. Don't worry, this happens. To get the thorough input or thorough knowledge what is being done, you require a lot of patience and rereading of the article. And sometimes at a particular paper we do not understand, then it doesn't matter. There are references at the end of the paper which have been referred by the author or researcher while doing some research work. Then we should refer to those particular material or earlier papers also, so that we can understand what has been done and what is being done and being covered in the present paper which we are going through. So we should read, always get the good papers from the esteemed journals, from the referred journals, and also from the SCI index journal. We should follow them to get the grip of the subject and also the algorithm. But still, if we find that something is lacking and we are not getting the basic knowledge of what is being done, then we can always refer to the books. It is better to go in and study the books thoroughly, and then we can understand the basic of the mathematical concept. And then again, we can reread and re-refer to the material and thereby to clarify the important issues with regard to our research. Then once we understand the algorithm, then we write to a program or simulate the algorithm. Then we have to compare our simulation based results to those from the original papers, and we have to make the analysis which is intelligent, right? And then we have to note down anything that affect the system, such as which parameters affect the results, etc., and also the limitations of the particular algorithm. And we have to find the alternative and compare the alternative to find out whether they are converging and they are representing the our research, whether it is going in the right direction. So that is very much important. And if which require to reiterate or rethink that we are not getting our results are not going in the right direction, so it doesn't matter, it is a part of research. No, it happens most of the time. Again, we have to rethink, and again we have to again prepare the algorithm or redo or change a little bit of a direction of research to improve upon it. Now, then we try the algorithm on the more challenging problems like nonlinear systems, large and complex problems, and what to do if our work is not going in the right direction. Then we have to think very deeply, and then we have to see what improvements is required and what direction we have to take to get our work in the right direction. And then after doing the analysis, then finally we can write the paper or the research report. So the main aspects which are covered under the research is, one is whenever we write the thesis, it covers introduction and significance. So basically it signifies why I am doing it. That is what has been done till now, what is the importance of this particular area, and why I am taking this topic, what is the need of going into the research in this particular field. Then another chapter generally which is written in our research thesis, it is the review of the research and identifying the research gaps. That is what is known, what is already known in the world, and what is still there is a gap, that is what is still unknown, that represents the area of the further research. Then the aims of research, what we want to, what is the objective of our research. So this help us to hope, that is we hope to discover the through these statements what we are going to do in the field of research and what we are going to discover during our research pathway. Then methodology, it highlights that how I am going to do my work, how I am going to discover the unknown in my research pathway. Then by experimenting or by following the particular methodology of maybe simulating, mathematical modeling, simulating and doing experimentation and validation, that is very much important. Whenever you do any work, you have to validate it by this reference method or by the statistical method. So that is, that depends upon the area of the research. So you have to see that the results which you have obtained is validated. Then you can express the results, that what has been found. Then discussion, what does it actually mean? Because the results, some will be conforming by what we have assumed or hypothesis which have made, but still there will be some gap or some of the, you can say the results, they might be mismatching by the assumption which we have made earlier. So that is another issue. Then conclusions, that is the last step, but it contains most of the, you can say, crux of our research. That is, what is the recommendations, what are the proper possible applications of the research work we have done, what has been done, in a gist we have to write. Then what contribution does it make to the knowledge, how the knowledge, incremental new knowledge has been discovered or it has been innovated while the person researchers have done work. And what is the next, that is what is the further scope of research in our from what work we have done. So that is also very important. So we can conclude that the qualities of good research includes that it is a systematic, it is logical, it is empirical, that it is based upon certain experimentation and measurements, and it is replicable, it can be done and proved anywhere. So that is replicable and area of the aspect of a good research. Now I am going to talk about, as an example, one of the upcoming field of research in engineering science, and that is the sustainable development. So we have discussed about what is research, what are the various aspects of research, how, what is the methodology of the research which is generally followed. Now let us see one of the area in which all the branches of our science as well as engineering, they are working upon. That is the sustainable development, a very much crucial area and very much necessary area of in the globe. Now, initially, this sustainable development was discussed globally in the United Nations Conference on Human Environment in 1972. Thereafter, United Nations Earth Summit was held in 1992 in Brazil, and in year 2000 on environment conservation, United Nations Conference was held. In the year 2002, UN Conference on Sustainable Development was also organized at Johannesburg. So, recognizing the importance of sustainable development, it requires to see the world as a system. A sustainable development is a system, basically, that connects time. That is, like, for example, how our grandparents formed the land. It affects the agriculture or agricultural practices which we are following today. And as an example, today's economic policy will impact the poverty when our children will become adults. Sustainable development also is connected through space. Like for air pollution from North America, it affects the air quality of the Asia. The pesticides in Argentina, it harms the fish stock at coast of Australia. So we all are connected together in time and space. Another important dimension of sustainable development is, like, a person may be physically healthy but without education. Is it a sustainable development? Another question arises, if we are having a good income but not a clean air to breathe in, does it lead to sustainable development? So it has a complex and interwoven problems. Therefore, the Brundtland reports published by the United Nations World, which was commissioned on environment and development, it states sustainable development is the development that meets the need of the society at present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. So it takes care of future also while fulfilling the current requirements or needs. It mainly contains of two concepts. One is needs, another is limitations. Needs in particular, they are the essential needs of the world's poor. That is, they should be given the first priority when we solve the, when we try to look into the problems. Their priority should be taken into consideration. And the limitations, they are imposed by the state of technology and social organization on the environment's ability to meet the present and the future need. So it is a multidimensional process. It covers social progress and social equity, economic development and growth, environmental protection and conservation. So there is a correlation between all three issues. Growth must be inclusive. It should be environmentally sound also. Now, keeping into view all these factors, the Millennium Development Goals were formed in the year 2000, and 8 anti-poverty targets that the world committed to achieve the sustainable development was, by the year 2015, that is after 15 years, it was to reducing the poverty, reducing the hunger, reducing disease, gender, reducing the gender inequality, and access of water and sanitation to all. So after that goals were formulated, the report, there was various steps taken to solve these problems. And after almost two decades, the report was formed based on the progress made under the Millennium Development Goals. So it was found that over past two decades, the economic growth was lifted more than 660 million people above the poverty, but there were still gaps, as you can see in this slide, that over 800 lakh people are still living on less than $1.25 a day. That is, the poor people are still there in our world. As compared to malnourishment and hunger, 1 in 9 persons in the world, they go hungry each day. We have high deforestation, oceans are becoming more acidic, and when it regards to education, 1 in 6 persons in the world is illiterate, and majority of them, that is 2/3 of them, are women. So there is imbalance between the progress which we have achieved by making the people more less poor and what is actually happening with regard to various sustainable development parameters. Now, when we see the situation of food, then 795 million people worldwide, they do not have enough food to eat. Hunger kills more than number of people as compared to the persons who cannot live because of HIV, AIDS, malaria, or tuberculosis combined. Approximately more than 195 million people are undernourished in India, which accounts for the highest number of people suffering from hunger in any single country. When we see the accessibility towards the water, 700 million people across the world don't have access to safe drinking water. And in India, 25% of the population just has the safe drinking water in the premises. Rest, they have to go and try to go out and get the water to meet their demands. And the biggest sufferer of them are women, because they generally go out and collect water. They have to go miles in a day to collect the water, especially the Rajasthan, Gujarat, and nowadays you can see even in the newspaper that in Maharashtra also droughtlet situation is there, and the people are very much affected due to the scarcity of water. So 67% of Indian households do not have clean water. It is either chemically or bacterially contaminated. And only 27% of the India's wastewater is being treated. And remainder, it just flows into rivers, canals, groundwaters, or sea, causing polluting our natural resources. When we look into the sanitation aspect, 802 million people do not have sanitation facilities. 21% of the communicable diseases in India are due to unsafe water. In India, diarrhea causes more than 1,600 deaths per day. And we have 1,000 persons who die every day because of tuberculosis. When we talk about the energy, here again, a lot of gaps still exist. Like, we have more than 1,200 million people who do not have access to electricity in the world. That is 17% of the total population, they do not have facility for having the electricity. In India, we have around 22% of the world's population that still do not have access to electricity. Still, more than 800 million in people, they cook their meals by burning biomass, since they are not having accessibility to LPG or other cleaner fuel. And when we talk about the our greenhouse gas emission, which is generally the major focus is on the carbon dioxide gas emission, which is the major source of pollution, then we see that still the scene is also very you can say it is not also very good. And as you can see that we are having a large global carbon dioxide emissions due to the fossil fuel used, as well as because of the cement production, where 36 gigatons of carbon dioxide is given out, and this is 61% more than the emission that was present in year 1990, and it is also, or you can see, 2.3% higher than the pollution in the year 2012. In 2014, again, the level of pollution is rising, and the main emissions are being caused by the China, USA, and other developed countries, and India also pollutes to the level of 7%. And the main source of pollution is coal, that is 43%, oil is 33%, gas is 18%, cement is 5.4%, and gas flaring contributes to 0.6%. Over 100 years, last 100 years, the concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, it has increased by 25%. And when we look at the fresh water, the consumption is doubling every 20 years. On the other hand, we have less than 1% of the potable water, that is the water which is good enough to clean to drink in our world, it is less than 1%. The Earth's forest, freshwater and marine environments, it has also reduced by 30%. And when we see the type of resources which we use, like which creates a pollution, for example, a mercury from a single fluorescent tube, it can pollute 30,000 liters of water. So there is a large number of challenges for engineers and scientists for meeting out the requirements of sustainable development. One is the food security. In the next 40 years, the demand for food around the world is expected to be more than double. That it is going to rise by 70%. So we want to feed more people with greater nutrition. We want to use less fertilizer, less chemicals and pesticides, and less water for irrigation. So that is also another area of research. Another area of research is that the drought-resistant wheat and corn, our cereals, and flood-resistant rice. Another area is using of less chemicals and fertilizers. That is how to get the nitrogen directly from the air with the help of bacteria that grows inside the plants. Another is area of issue is the genetically modified food. And very important area is the water security. How to retain the water, or how to make this resource manageable and available for our future generations. When we talk of our country, we import more than 70% of oil to meet our energy demands, which comes to be around more than 180 million tons of oil, which we import, 110 million tons of coal we import, and 16 billion cubic meters of natural gas per year we import. You see, we import the coal, although we have a large quantity of coal, but the coal available is of not good quality. It has high ash content. So that is why we have to import the coal also from other countries. Although India is the world's fifth largest generator of electricity with around 243 gigawatt, but still the power of the demand for the electricity is growing because of the increased population and higher standard of living. Although we have touched the renewable energy installation by more than 32,000 megawatt, or 13% of the total potential of around 250,000 megawatt in our country. But still, there is a lot of gap and a lot of work needs to be done to manage these resources efficiently. Another is the bio-based world integrated concepts for biomass and bioprocess engineering, like biorefineries, bio-based products, biocatalyst, and biomass conversion processes. Then another challenge is biomass based production, wind energy based production and generation, then art of innovation for the novelty in process products and services, biodiesel production, that is another area of research which is very much being done, and how through algae we can get our biofuel to replace our oils in our vehicles. Then another area is bioservices, biopharmaceuticals, bioagriculture, bioindustry, and bioinformatics, and also biocatalyst or bioprocessing technologies, which needs to be researched further. Another area is reduction of cost of medicines to make them more affordable by the poor. Then there is a lot of upcoming area that is in the area of plastic industry, with application in the field of automobiles, food packaging, healthcare, retail, and production. which will be, it is projected that it will raise to 20 million tons by 2020 from the current capacity. There is a scope of research in the functional materials like advanced materials, new materials or novel materials, devices, processes and analysis technologies for LED-based lighting system, organic photovoltaic, organic photo semiconductors, etc. So the major development challenges, it includes climate change. So we have to have the technologies which produce lesser emission, lesser waste, how to manage our e-waste, biodiversity, then disaster risk reduction like prediction of earthquake, flood, etc. Then sustainable consumption and production using less energy consumption, more production, in the and how to modify our processes and production technologies. Education and building disaster resilient, climate resilient, low emission societies and sustainable communities. And green economies like organic production, green catalyst, green energy, that is another area. The fulfillment of these challenges through solutions require to reorientation and innovation of technology, and which is the key link between the humans and the nature. The major challenges of sustainable development includes reduction of the carbon dioxide emission, reducing the global warming, rising sea level, deforestation, arresting ozone layer depletion, arresting climate change, and how does and it has its adverse effects on the biodiversity and generates a higher risk of disaster and health. As you can find, more earthquakes are coming, tsunami is there. So it is all because of the climate change. And even our sea water level is rising, thereby it will reduce the land. As you can see, that it is predicted by the year 2025, our sea level will rise by around 55 centimeters. So there is an annual loss of forest land globally. That is another area of concern. And on the other side, energy consumption per capita in the countries like India, China, and Brazil, it is also increasing day by day. So how to meet these requirements? Another challenge is the oil production. The shift from extraction to new era paradigm with energy, that is renewable and clean energy we want, ecology, we should preserve our ecology for sustainable development, and equity, that is equal access of energy, food and health for all, especially the poorest of the poor. So the next generation knowledge intensive solutions is required for balancing the ecology and economic process through energy efficient consumption and creation of new energy and materials. So we should design for social and economic needs the technologies which may be related to health, sustainability and converging technologies in the areas of pharmaceutical, food, security, transport, industrial process and next manufacturing process. Like for health, biopharmaceutical drug delivery, drug discovery, biomaterials and tissues, engineering, biosensors, computational modeling, new catalyst, fuel cells, hydrogen generation and storage, renewable energy sources, processes with low risk of environment pollution. Then another converging technologies are nanostructures, nanomaterials, photonics, optoelectronics, polymer composites, material technologies, surface technologies, computational modeling, sensors, etc. That is another area. If we talk about one of the area that is sustainable chemistry, then it covers the catalysis, solvent replacement, use of renewable feedstock, waste minimization in production, process intensification, more energy efficient production processes, separation processes, safer reaction and reagents. So these are also part of the upcoming research. So this sustainable growth model, it covers the economic policy, education also, health, defense, agriculture and productive development. Another new horizons with respect to the our research is the alternative energy, that is we have to go in for the ecological friendly, sustainable and safe energy sources to meet our energy demands. Nano manufacturing mechanisms at nanoscale to yield products of high quality with zero wastage. Novel and new materials through efficiency of usage of materials, for example, shape, memory alloys, and new fibers, etc. Biocatalyst involving microorganisms and enzymes to catalyze the reactions such as polymerization without any harmful or toxic releases and at normal conditions. Then genetic reforestation, production of healthier and fast growing trees using principles of genetics and biotechnology to arrest our deforestation. Waste recycling is making optimum use of recycling for productively to utilize the waste materials. Another fields are process industry reconfiguration in upstream and downstream processing by nanotechnology, information technology, and biotechnology integration. Development of biofuel from various type of agriculture and other resources from the fiber residue, energy crop, oil crop. Then we have to look into the processes like gasification, pyrolysis, anaerobic digestion, fermentation, distillation, microbial digestion, etc. to produce hydrogen, methanol, biodiesel, etc., which can be used in diesel, gasoline, and other vehicles. The next generation nuclear power plant design, it requires innovative chemical engineering knowledge in recycling of spent fuel, in safety also as a strategic problem solver. Then there is a scope of work in extraction, exploitation, and experimentation for harmony with new technology, converting the agro biomass to energy and power through solar blend and fuel cell processes with the knowledge for recovery and recycling to get the clean energy and clean water. Now, one of the area is the biodiesel. India has a scope in manufacturing the biodiesel, as you can see, because we have a large generally the feedstock on which the research has been done is karanja, jatropha, neem, palm, and soybean. And according to the National Remote Sensing Agency at Hyderabad, we have 55 million hectares of wasteland which can be used to produce the vegetation, so as we can produce the biodiesel for it. But it is seen then if for irrigating the soybean biodiesel production during cultivation, 6,500 liters of water is used for every liter of biodiesel. So we want to reduce this. This is a particular area of research. Because for biodiesel production process, for around 1 liter of water for every liter of biodiesel produced is used. And so this is another area. Another horizons for doing research is the water management that I've discussed. Now identifying the land on which, so that it doesn't limit our agricultural production, our food stock. That is very much important. It should not be at the cost of our basic cereals, vegetables, and other food which we consume. Then increasing how to increase the yield, how to use the how to have the reusable catalyst, and storage issues regarding the biodiesel, because it gets spoiled very quickly. So that is another issue. How to store it for a longer shelf life. Then engine performance and emission, it is also affected if we use biodiesel instead of in the conventional engine. What should be the appropriate blending ratio? What should be the fuel injection map for biodiesel and compatibility with other devices? Then durability of the engine, improving the economies, the multi-cropping, using of other and purification of glycerol. So these are some of the areas. And then another area of research is like, for example, wind energy. We have a large potential to harness the wind energy, and we are harnessing it to a large extent. India is ranking fifth globally with regard to wind generation, and it is emerged as the second largest wind market in Asia. But the main challenge with respect to the wind energy on the onshore and offshore, you see there are two methods by which we harness the wind energy. One is onshore, that is on the land when we install the wind turbines on windmills, and one is when we turbine the offshore wind power, that is when we install the turbines on our sea. So it has a environmental impacts, that is wind, like deforestation, land acquisition, bird hits. It adversely affects on marine and wildlife, and it has a noise and flicker generated by the wind turbines. So offshore wind energy is also looked at as a good option, but still it has certain issues, like we have to have the correct we have to have the wind data. You see, whenever we want to install any renewable energy source, then we should have the data that how much wind is available at a particular time in a particular area, and to collect the data regarding the wind availability at the sea at a particular height, it is not an easy issue. So that is another area which needs to look upon. Then another is the installation of these wind turbines, like wind data, which generally you see we have a center for wind energy technology at Chennai, which looks at the wind data, and generally it collects the data with wind speed at 20 meter height from the sea level. But how to collect this at the land? Okay, it is possible, but what about the at the sea? To calculation of the annual mean wind speed, annual power density and capacity factors, etc. So in offshore, the wind resources evaluation is much more complex, and the cost is also very high. It is 33% more expensive to install the wind at offshore on the sea as compared to onshore. And then there is a difficulty of sea operation with regard to construction and operation. So although we have a large potential of renewable energy sources, but only around 13% of these sources have been exploited so far. Solar is having the largest potential in our country to be used, but still around 2% of this source has been exploited. So the main thing is the cost with respect to solar photovoltaic. So there is a need for research in the reduction in the consumption of silicon, which is majorly used as a source for converting our solar energy into the DC voltage and power generation, and other materials in the conventional crystalline silicon applications. So this is another area because it requires high cost of manufacturing. Then we require high efficiency silicon device, higher efficiency modules for thin film application based on silicon and other materials, nanostructure devices such as organic or organic and inorganic hybrid devices and dye cells, improved power electronics to enhance output quality and compatibility with smart grid schemes. Another area of research, hybridization of various renewable energy sources or synchronization of these sources in the smart grid as per the requirements of the user. So that is another area of research. Then grid integration issues for high level penetration, including large distance DC transport, improved power electronics to enhance output quality and compatibility with the smart grid schemes, then high throughput, high yield integrated processing with increased automation across all model types, improved sustainability of production, including the use of recycled material. Another issue is the big data management and security issues. Intelligent machine is another area of research. So this was regarding the various areas of research which are there, and the various issues which are there, which need to be looked upon when we talk about the research and development in the engineering. And also in the beginning, I have highlighted what is the methodology, research methodology, what do we mean by research, and what is how the systematic research is carried out. So this was regarding the overview of the research in the engineering and sciences. So now the house is open for question answer. So I'll request the participants from the various centers to ask any question with regard to this session. So I'll start from the center. Dronacharya Group of Institution, Greater Noida. Any question regarding these issues of sustainable development and research?
Hello.
Yes.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am, we have no questions regarding sustainable development. But okay. I have a question regarding validity of research.
Okay.
Suppose I have an idea and I need to publish a paper on it, and yeah. I'm working on an algorithm, and yeah. I have done thorough study of different developers, programmers who have done research in that area, and I cannot find anything similar to that idea. But by mm-hmm. the time I'm publishing my research, I find out that something similar has been done in that area, similar mm-hmm. to that, my algorithm. So how mm-hmm. do I proceed with my research then?
Then you have to have divergent thinking. You have to think out the alternative to that. Because as I discussed in my presentation also, that sometimes it happens. We are working and some other researchers across are also working in the same direction. So we have to be very alert and we have to redefine now our alternative strategies to meet the research objective. That sometimes it happens. So it doesn't matter, it is a part of research. Whenever you do research, there will be some different issues which will come up. So it happens with almost every researcher. So don't worry, you have to find the alternative strategy to meet your research objective through different model. So you have to do it in a different way.
Okay.